We're up on our way to the upper Cliftons right now, taking this trail, and what an interesting journey we're going to be on today. It's really nice that they allow us to do this because, you know, I know this upper level is not easier, but I don't expect it to be too difficult today. But, you know, there is the Cliftoning, the lower Cliftoning right there, and then we're going to go up to the upper and take this trail. And I'm sure we're not going to get concrete all the way, but, you know, I'm expecting it to be a really nice, pleasant hike. I mean, you know, elevation's elevation, whether the trail's perfect or not, but I'm expecting the trail to be pretty nice considering that, you know, it is the Park Service, so they really do a nice job of making sure the trails are here. But I'm looking forward to the journey today, and it's nice that we have volunteers that take care of this stuff, so. You'll look right here. Now these hills here are growing back, but they were devastated by the fire that came through here. And it's so hard to hold on to these hillsides without some type of vegetation. So I'm glad it's coming back, even though it's not coming back with native grasses. But I'm trying not to interrupt everybody on their journey up here, but it's really going to be an interesting climb to the Tonto upper ruins. I hope you guys get your hiking shoes on.
Yeah, as we head up this way, we're going to get into, like I said, a riparian area. It's going to be dark. Might be a little cooler in there, but today even the breeze is fairly warm, so it probably won't be too uncomfortable. As we go up, we're going to be on a ridge line at parts of the time, and it could get pretty windy. Maybe not this morning, but on the way back, it could be kind of windy. So just be prepared to hold on to your hats if the wind gets blowing. Up ahead, as we go through this riparian area, we're going to see some different trees. Any guesses on what kind of trees you might see in the desert down here?
Mesquite.
Lots of mesquite. Big tall ones with the white bark, it's actually sycamore. Now, if anyone knows about sycamores, they have to have water pretty much year-round to survive. When you see sycamore trees that are alive, there's water. It may not be on the surface, but there's definitely water. You get lost in the desert, you see sycamore trees, you have shade, and you can probably get water by digging down. Up ahead, you can see a massive, really dark barked tree. It's like black behind me here. Guesses on what that might be? Usually a big surprise for anyone coming into the Sonoran Desert, not expecting to see giant walnut trees. Walnut. So here in the Sonoran Desert, that's native. There's walnut trees and there's sycamore trees in all kinds of different canyons throughout the desert. You just normally don't see them because they're tucked away where people don't get to them to harvest them. Okay, so we're kind of coming into the heart of what's left of our riparian area back here. You can see this massive tree trunk behind you. That was a big living tree. You can see just how close the fire came to destroying the rest of this. It was close. Firefighters did manage to save this zone in here. So we're thankful for that. This is a significant wildlife habitat. There's a lot of wildlife that comes in here because of the water. I don't know if you can see it from where you're standing, but right below me, here's the water that's actually on the surface for just a couple hundred feet or less. One of their food sources, along with what we have right here, are mesquite trees. Mesquite trees are known to Native Americans as the tree of life. They have, during part of the year, they grow long seed pods, and all of that seed pod is edible. The seeds can be ground onto flour. You can chew on the pod. It's like a chewing gum. It's actually a little sweet, and it'll also help keep your mouth salivating. So it's useful for that. It also turns out you can eat the flowers,
you know, so they could garnish their meal and put a little flour in there, give it a little more, I added vitamins to their foods. In addition to that, you can make a tea out of it, and it helps, let's say you have ulcers or a sore throat or something like that, it has medicinal properties. It'll help heal those type of issues. And so the Native Americans knew all this, and so they used these on a regular basis. So they actually, you know, thrive by having all these mesquite trees around. They're very important to them. The poles that make up the skeleton is made up of a bunch of these poles, and they're kind of hooked together with wood. So they could cut them, and they would lash them together, make a tool where they could knock fruit off of the sorrel cactus. And so that was a good tasty treat for them and a really good food source. They could collect a lot of it. There were thousands and thousands of saguaros just in this area. We've lost a lot of them to the fires, but there's still some. And so they would have used that. It's also used in construction of the cliff dwellings. And so up at the cliff dwellings, we'll be able to see some of the original workmanship that was done, some of the original construction. And you'll see where the saguaro ribs, as we call them, were used in construction. How many think we can drink water out of a saguaro cactus? Out of a barrel cactus? Never. Never, ever, ever. Absolutely full of really bad bacteria. Really, really make you sick. Okay?
For both of them?
Both of them. Okay? So you hear these myths about, you know, tapping water out of a saguaro cactus or a barrel cactus. No, that's not accurate. Another type of cactus to point out is right here, this real beautiful fuzzy looking thing. Who knows what that one is?
Chola.
It's a cholla. Oh. I know, you don't, it's C-H-O-L-L-A,
right.
But in Spanish, you don't pronounce the L's, it's cholla. And no locals who know the other name for it, then I'm guessing. We call it the jumping cactus, jumping cholla. It is mean.
For food?
You do not want to get close to that guy. It has little microfilaments coming off of the bar, off of the spines, and you don't even know you're that close necessarily. It'll catch you, and any kind of tension, it comes off under tension and flings in. It'll stick into you with a whole bunch of thorns. Up above, to the right, there's the walls of the upper cliff dwelling. So that's where we're heading to right now. Also, right behind us here is a fence line. So this fence line is the boundary of Tonto National Monument. So the National Monument grounds ends here on the south side with this fence line. The other side of it is National Forest land. Not much of a forest by what a lot of us think a forest is, but it's National Forest controlled land.
How beautiful is that lake down there? I'll tell you what, that is beautiful. It's really awesome when you get in here and you see the beauty of the area. Tonto is definitely a beautiful place.
Okay, so the buckhorn cactus was actually essential to healthy life hundreds of years ago. There's one thing that we get that they couldn't get. So this was their source, and that was calcium. The last segment of each of these buckhorn cactuses is highly concentrated calcium. There were no cows. They didn't have sheep. They didn't have any way to get milk like we were, you know, early on. And they didn't have any other, you know, vitamin stores and supplements like that. So this buckhorn cactus was really important to them. A cactus. So there's like food everywhere out here in the desert.
If you burn it, does that mean you roasted it?
You're roasting it, exactly.
Ah.
Roasted prickly pear. Now, if you're interested in trying some kind of prickly pear products, down in the visitor center, there's prickly pear jams, and there's prickly pear candies, and there's prickly pear salsa. You know, it's actually made into a lot of different food products.
a lot of people don't realize how devastating that fire really was. If you go down to Fish Creek and you go down through some of that areas that were totally devastated by the fire. So, you know, sometimes it's natural and that's understandable, but you know, if you're out there, be careful, man. Make sure that you put out the fires. Make sure that you don't get a hot vehicle in high grass. That does happen. And we're not lacking any wind today. But, man, what an easy trail today. You know, we've had such hard trails lately. This is nice to get an easy, you know, an easy hike, thank goodness. Now that we're up here, one little known fact about that reservoir down there is that in, I believe, 1919, a gentleman was flying his plane around the world. Now, it ended up being one with pontoons. And he was an Italian, so he landed in this lake to refuel on his journey around the world. And while they were refueling that plane, it caught fire and burnt. That's a little known fact. A lot of people don't know about that fact.
Okay, while we're waiting here. So everything that you saw that was brought up in here, including some of the wood beams and posts that you're going to see, they brought in by hand. Horses didn't show up until the Spanish showed up later on, and much later. So they had to port things by hand. So that's another thing to think about while you're up in here. You're like, wow, this was a lot of work. This was a very laborious task, but. They believe, based on evidence, that they probably started building this upper dwelling and the lower dwelling around the early 1300s and lived in them through the early 1400s. So 100 to 130-ish years or so, possibly living in these dwellings, building and living in them. They did not build all the rooms at once. This was, let's build a place and now we're going to live here. And maybe the family expands and now we're building another room or something like that. Or maybe there's groups of people and then they started to build more. But there's some evidence that they would build this and then this and then this and then this. You can just kind of tell those that know architecture, they can say, yeah, this had to be here before this was added and then this was added. So this was a work in progress over a long period of time. We're going to go down here a little bit, but real quick, I want to point out a couple things. So right in front of me here, you can just see this opening. So it's filled in with a bunch of dirt and rock. So normally the opening would be a bit bigger, but that piece of wood right there is original. Now that one's more exposed to the sun and to any kind of moisture, so it's getting fairly decayed. Up above it, you can see another board. On that wall behind there, it's not as nearly as decayed. And so this is all wood. They did use wood in these. They also did post and beam type construction to make ceilings and slash floors for the second story, because some of this was two stories. So again, a lot of this is absolutely original, untouched. So now, up in this indented area here, you see this wall. You see a whole bunch of holes in it. And to the left side, you actually see some wooden pieces sticking out. So not this one here close up, but back indented in there. So those are beams, and that would make the floor for the second story. So the first story would be below that, and the second story would be above that. And then the top height would be up there about where the white is, maybe a little higher than that. So that would be what you would typically see is a bunch of these little wooden beams sticking out the side. And that's where the ceiling is for the first story and the floor for the second story. And we'll see some of that close up when we go up inside the top part. This angled wall right here, that's something that came out of Europe. It's called a flying buttress. It's a way to support a wall. I think the Native Americans knew how to do that hundreds of years ago. We learned from them. Now, this actually was done by the Park Service. This is one of the few things that was done to try to replicate the look. So if you look at it, it looks like it matches pretty well. But we don't do this anymore nowadays either. But it's been left here. Now it's kind of part of history, early history for the Park Service. But this was also put in to help keep that wall from falling and buckling out any further. Now, this wall, which, sorry, we used to be able to bring people right into here, but we can't now, is doing that same thing. It's starting to buckle out. And so they've temporarily put braces to help keep it from falling. They have to determine how they're going to work with this one. In the end, it may come down. We may have to take it down just so it's safe. Hopefully, in the future, we can open this back up or we can take people inside. But for today, for this period, we can't do that. But, you know, there's a typical, again, over the top of the doorway. So you go to some different cliff-dwelling type sites and other home sites from Native Americans, you won't see that same exact architecture where they have a essentially a board. It's almost like rough sawn lumber. It's pretty much a flat board that they created to use in each of these entryways. So up above us here, you can see this kind of a square opening. That one's pretty wide. A lot of times they're thinner than that. It's probably about the right height. So is that a nice window for viewing out? Is that a doorway?